This hymn this morning is one of my favorite hymns. We're in a battle each and every day, spiritual warfare. And this hymn exhorts us to stand firm and to be strong. So let us stand today as we sing our hymn of worship, Sound the Battle Cry, hymn number 614. Sound the battle cry.
Sound the battle cry. See the foe is nigh. Raise the standard high for the Lord. Gird your armor on. Stand firm, everyone. Rest your cause upon his holy.
Strong to meet the foe.
Strong to meet the foe. Marching as we go. While our cause we know must prevail. Shield and banner bright. Gleaming in the light. Battling for the right. We ne'er can fail. Rouse them soldiers. Rally round the banner.
Thou God of all,
O Thou God of all, hear us when we call, help us one and all by Thy grace. When the battle's done and the victory's won, may we wear the crown before.
Everyone, rouse then,
rouse.
Happy Sabbath, church.
Happy Sabbath.
The word of God says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good and his mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generations. In my distress, I cried unto the Lord, and he heard me. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Father, we thank you for this holy Sabbath day. Lord, we pray that you will just be in this service, that you will bless every song, every prayer, every spoken word. Bless the speaker of the hour, that she may speak from on high. Anoint her lips. And Lord, when it's all said and done, may we continue throughout the Sabbath day giving you the highest praise, saying hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. To God be the glory. Amen.
Be seated. Happy Sabbath. My name is Vonda Hendrickson, and I am so glad to see everyone here today. Here at Decatur, we tend our church garden. We have rows of turnips. We turn up the smile. We turn up for worship. We turn up with our Bibles. We turn up the love. We have rows of squash. So delicious. And we're so determined to squash criticism and squash gossip. Finally, we have rows of lettuce. Oh, my favorite. Let us love one another in Jesus' name. Let us welcome each other as friends. Let us be faithful to our duty for Christ's sake. Let us worship God together. Welcome, church family. Glad to see you in the garden. Will all of our first-time visitors please stand and remain standing? Wonderful. Any others? Thank you. Thank you. We invite you to come again anytime you're passing through to see us in the garden. And if you're moving to the area, you are invited to join our fellowship each Sabbath and midweek as we tend garden planting new plants until the harvest time. This is our time to fellowship, pruning and tending our precious plants. Pastor, these are our visitors in our garden today.
Happy Sabbath to everyone. Oh, we can do better than that. Happy Sabbath to everyone. If you feel the warmth of the Lord inside of you, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Are you cold this morning? Oh no, it's a Florida morning. Claim it, believe it, walk in it, and I promise you, you will feel so warm that you would take off some of the layers that you have on. But just wait for the Lord to hit you before you do that, okay? It is so good to see many of you out on this beautiful Sabbath morning. And we want to say thank you to our visitors for making this day special for us. We love you, and we love when you come and worship with us. It's my prayer that as you enjoy yourself here, that the message, the worship, would transform your life. And when you arrive home, when you continue with your busy day, I pray that something transpiring here will remind you of God's love. So welcome to Decatur, to our church family. It's good to see you all. Some of you just couldn't wait to see me. I can tell. So I want to just rebuke this notion. Someone called me this morning, early this morning. No, gave me a phone call. And I will admit, I was hurt. I was sad. But I still have hope. And we shall rise again next year. And so for those who may not know, don't worry. For those who are chuckling, they know. Your pastor's going to be all right. I will make it. I will make it. Praise the Lord. Somebody say amen. They're worrying about what's wrong with our pastor. He's okay. Simply, we lost last week. Yeah, the Cowboys, we lost last week. Okay? So let me put it out there, all right? So you don't have to go home and search and worry. What pastor? I'm okay. I had a mental health day. I needed one. But we're going to be okay. Sister Craig, I still believe. So I will receive all comments. I will receive all jokes, memes, whatever. For this 1 week, I will receive it. I'm big enough. I can take it. Now, after next week, I'm going to be petty. I'm going to be petty like Patti LaBelle. So you got your 1 week. Take it. I'm open for it. But nevertheless, it's always great to joke with your church. Somebody say amen. It's great to laugh. It's great to know that we can just let it down a little bit and just enjoy the moment. So happy Sabbath to you. We have our great associate pastor by the name of... Andrew Nixon, who will bring our announcements and will also bring some initiatives to us. I love this guy. I really do love him.
You know, the reason why he keeps saying that is because we'll be together sometimes. We were recording something one day, and then he said, I'm going to bring on my associate pastor, Pastor John. Oh, wait, never mind. We had to scrap the whole thing and start over again because he keeps calling me John Nixon. Happy Sabbath, church family. I am not a Cowboys fan. So my hope is in Jesus, and I'm happy today. The Bible says... The Bible says, lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. Right. You know. If you do that, you know that you don't have to be high or low with the change in times or seasons. Do I need to get my Bible and preach right now? But that's all right. That's all right. I'm in the comforting ministry as well, Pastor. You know, I'm always in the comforting ministry. I'm a shoulder to cry on. It's okay. But happy Sabbath, everyone. It is wonderful to be in God's house with you again. It is cold outside. I don't know about this Florida stuff. I'm from Alabama, and when I woke up this morning, I felt cold. But I do believe that if Jesus is in the room, we have warmth in our hearts and we have something to be excited about. Amen? So I'm so happy to see all of you here. And I'm so happy. I was over in the Family Life building and I saw all the children. It's cold outside, but their energy and their joy and their vigor and vitality, it knows no temperature at which it stops, like some of us who may slow down when it gets colder. So all of the kids are over there, and I just want to make mention of the fact that if you're visiting with us or maybe you do not know, we are having children's church today. And so our children are over in our Family Life building. There's a whole program planned out. So if you have children that you would like to take over for our children's church, it is over in the Family Life building, and they have a wonderful program planned for them that you can partake of. I just have a couple of other announcements that I want to bring to your attention. We mentioned previously that in light of our season, there is a winter coat drive that is ongoing. We are partnering with the DeKalb Alphas, to donate coats for ages, or rather grades first through fifth grade. And so if you have a coat for a child in that age range that you are willing to donate, we ask, yes, something, and we mentioned that last week, pastors reminded me, yes, something that you would put on a child that you love, amen? If you have something like that, we are accepting donations. The contact information is in the bulletin, and we just wanted to highlight that again this week. Also, we want to remind you that the Healthy Self Challenge, those of you who are looking at starting off 2024 on the right foot, I know some people mentioned about wanting to lose some weight and things. I can't really lose any weight, but it's important for us to be healthy. Amen? To partake in the laws of health and to practice good health habits. And so we want to remind you that the Healthy Self Challenge is ongoing. I believe it's for 10 weeks. Is that correct? 10 weeks. And they will be meeting on Sundays in the Family Life Center. And so if you did not sign up on last week, there is still an opportunity for you to do that. And the contact information for our leaders is in the bulletin, and you can do that. So we want to encourage you to be the best version of yourself. Body, mind, and spirit. So you can take part in that. Also, I want to make mention of the fact, this is not in your bulletin, but our Pathfinders are having investiture service this afternoon at 4:30. What time did I say? Now, I know we all like to go home and eat, and the Sabbath nap takes place and all of those things, but it's important that we support our young people. Amen? I really mean that. As a pastor, I'm always trying to support everything that a church is doing. But I think it's really important that we support our young people. We want to let them know that we love them, we support what they are doing, and that they're not alone. So I want to encourage us to support our young people, the new Pathfinders who are getting on board. 4:30 this afternoon, the investiture service is just to acknowledge and induct those new Pathfinders into the Pathfinder Club. So 4:30 here in the church, we want to invite you back for that. And the last announcement that I want to make mention of, I wonder if I see, I can't see that great with these lights in my eyes, if I see Sister Walker and Sister Williams, our prayer ministries leaders. Are they here in the building this morning or this afternoon? All right, would you mind coming down here for me? Yes, I'm gonna do that to you. Yes, both of you, come on down. Sister Walker and Sister Williams are the leaders of our prayer ministries department. And if you don't know, for the last 10 days, we went through 10 days of prayer and fasting. And how many of you got an opportunity to get on Zoom one of the nights to participate? Wasn't that great? I mean, it was wonderful. It was an opportunity for us to be renewed, to be revitalized, to start off the year on the right foot. And if you missed it, I feel sorry for you, but based upon the reviews that I saw, I'm sure we will be doing this again next year. So I wanted to bring up Sister Walker and Sister Williams and acknowledge them for the work that they put into this and for all of those who participate. I know there was a different department every night that was leading out, and it was excellent. So Pastor Lewis is going to come on and make some remarks about this.
So it's always great to acknowledge and to give roses to those who are well deserving of them. Somebody say amen. Amen. It is not an easy task to put a program together every night and round up a group of leaders to stay focused on the task of quality and purposeful ministry. Nothing rendered that week was without a touch of class. And that's because our leaders set the tone for excellence. And I want to say thank you on behalf of your pastoral staff. We want to say thank you. We appreciate the time, the effort that you put in to making this an experience for us. And if we can't stand at this time, and let's love on these two great giants, spiritual warriors of this great church. We want to say thank you. God bless you and continue to motivate us to pray and pray some more. Thank you so much. So at this time, as we continue to focus on our prayer emphasis for the year, a growing church is a praying church. And here at Decatur, prayer will be the center of our motivation and the center of our core value. Somebody say amen. Amen. So we want to covenant with you this year. And we have this beautiful prayer card. And we want to start today a prayer covenant with you for the things you want God to do for you. This is a promise I make to you. As your pastoral family, we will pray for you every week in the office, dedicating your needs and desires, petitioning for your healing. But we want a point of contact so we can say to the Lord, remember this covenant. And so today you will receive these covenant cards. And we want you to be honest and to be faithful in placing your request on these cards. And every Sabbath, as we will have spiritual men and women mount this pulpit, they will take this box and they will present it to the Lord every Sabbath on your behalf. And every week, Pastor Nixon and I and Elder Williams and other spiritual leaders will come together and we're going to covenant with you and we're going to pray for you over this box. And what we want from you, we're going to open a segment of our program every Sabbath morning, afternoon, so that you can testify when the Lord has done that thing for you. We want to be encouraged. And the Bible declares we are encouraged when you tell us that God did it. Will you covenant with us today? Ushers, will you please start to distribute the cards out? Take your time. Be honest with yourself and with the Lord. Bring the card back next week, or if you are done today, you can drop the card off. The box will be in the back. Put it in the box. We will not read it. We will not invade your privacy, I promise you. But we will pray for you. We will cry aloud. We will petition, and we will even fast for you. Because we want miracles to happen this year. Somebody say amen. Do you believe? Amen. Will you covenant with the family of God? Amen. And I just believe we will have the power of the Holy Ghost moving through this place. So God bless you as we covenant together through prayer. and our prayer warriors, our prayer ministry directors will grab this box, and I know they're going to have their own special time to pray for this box. So we're excited. Let's covenant together. God bless you.
While the ushers are passing out those cards and everyone's getting them, I just want to invite up the family of Levi Zakai Francois Perry. We have a baby dedication. So if Young Master Levi would bring his family with him on down here, we would appreciate it at this time so we can dedicate him back to the Lord.
Father Akeem and Mother Kiana, come on and join us at this time. Oh, what a beautiful family. Brother Levi. Come right up here, Kiana. Awesome. What a beautiful village. Somebody say amen. Come on, we can encircle the family. Come on, we have a white theme here. I love it. There is a beautiful imagery when a family comes together to dedicate a child to the Lord. The Bible declares that every little one that's given to us is a heritage from the Lord. It's an opportunity to extend your family history, to give to the world another version of you. And as we consider what the world is offering, it's hard to believe that we have many who will start the journey of rearing children without the Lord. It's hard just to be an adult. Do we have a witness in here? Let alone a parent. This little one is smiling because at this moment, Kiana, you are the safest thing in this world. Oh, he's not concerned about what he's going to eat, when he's going to sleep, all your poopy diapers. He's not concerned about where he's going to get that bottle from, because in your arm, there's safety. In your arm, there's protection. He knows his mama. He knows the love. He knows you personally. And that smile says it all. That's my mama, and I love her. And to my friend, the man, the father, the king, the lion of the house, God has called you to lead with excellence, to show Levi what a real Christian man is. And it's often because you will hear people say, well, you know, he's not attending church, pastor. He's not reading the Bible. But there's a little secret. You know right from wrong, regardless if you read the Bible. You know why? Because there's a Holy Spirit that speaks to you. You have parents and you have guardians. And when I say guardians, you have surrogate parents and aunties and grandparents. They're praying for you. They're covering you. And they're simply saying, lead this little one to be a productive citizen, to be a good human being, to trust the Lord. And the only way he will do that, he would have to learn from both of you together. Three things I want to say to you, I'm done. Three things. You ready? Number one, he's not a baby. He's a child of the King. What do you mean, Pastor? Treat him as you would treat the King. Love him. Respect him. And when you want to do in your character what pleases you, remember, he's a child of the King. He's watching. And he deserves to have the best example. And that's the best of the both of you working together. So he's a child of the King. Number two, his morals for this time and his formative years will be based on you two. So let me be very honest with you. If you're cussing, he's going to cuss. If you're going to fight, he's going to fight. Because he is watching you. And I want this little one to be raised as a respectable Christian male, strong in his values, and a man of excellence, and a man that fears the Lord. And last of all, and this is big, regardless of what's transpiring between you two, do not take it out on him. That's word. He deserves to have the best version of both of you every day. Regardless of how you may feel before you enter into that house, check yourself. And regardless of what he may say to you, regardless of what argument you might have had with him, remember, if you disrespect him, that's all he will know from a woman. So regardless of what's transpiring, ask the Lord to remove it so he will receive the best version of both of you. And I believe God has called both of you for a season that's greater than your desires. It's all about him. So it's my desire and it's my privilege. And I'm always excited with these special services to take this little one and to dedicate him to the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the privilege we have to return this precious child to you. Levi is a special name called to serve you, to promote your name in the earth. And so, God, today I pray that this one, this child, birth with a purpose, would dedicate his heart to you so that he can lead men and women to your throne. Father, we pray for the parents that they will submit to your lordship and they will give the best version of a Christian that they can produce. And when they fall short, you will make up the difference. So, Father, we dedicate this whole family. Take this group, this unit. Mold them, create in them a clean heart, renew their spirits. And then, God, I pray, as this little one will learn from them, that he will be the man that you have called him to be because of the examples that will be granted through the two parents united to raise him. Akeem and Kiana, God bless you as you follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. So take your child, love him, care for him, and make him into your image. In the blessed name of Jesus, we pray. Let everyone say amen and amen. At this time, we have gifts on behalf of our departments and institutions.
It's God's Word, and Bible simply stands for biblical instruction before leaving earth. So when you stand on God's Word, you're on a sure foundation. You can build on that. You can grow as man and woman. And Levi, Master Levi, he comes from the tribe of Judah, Levi tribe. So you have a great responsibility. Study this word, stand on this word. Amen. God bless you.
Good morning. I'm Patrina Watkins, the director of the Decatur Adventist Learning Center, and I'm so happy that you took the first step in his early life of dedicating him back to the Lord. I'll encourage you to take the next best step, which is to bring him to the center so that we can provide further spiritual, social, emotional, and academic sustenance to make him of service to God first and to man second. So I would like to present this token, and we welcome you. Thank you.
I'm like the pastor. I get excited when we talk about baby blessings because there's two things that are important in our Christian journey. One is baptism, and the other is realizing that we need Christ and bringing our children to Christ. I want to talk to you all directly, okay? I represent the cradle roll. The cradle roll is the smallest part, the youngest people that we bring to Christ. We have Sabbath school every Sabbath at 10:45, right over there at the Family Life Center. I drive an hour up here to beg you to bring your child to Sabbath school. You know why? Because miracles happen in Cradle Roll. We had one today. First they come and they sit, then they grow and they start saying their memory verse, then they start singing and they're clapping. Why am I telling you this? Because we need for you to help us nurture your child. I didn't mean to make him cry. That's another reason he needs to come to Sabbath school. We're delighted that you chose our church to bring your child to be blessed. We want you to be a part of our family. I want you to bring him to Sabbath school. And on behalf of the Cradle Roll Department, I give you this gift. But I also want you to remember that I know who you are now. And I need the baby in Sabbath school, okay? Thank you.
And I want you to know she'll do a drive-by too. Come here, mama. So we are so appreciative for matriarchs, for mothers standing and covering their families. Somebody say amen, their families. And so I know you are happy, and we are so happy that we can render this service, and we want to now give this beautiful certificate to the matriarch and to the family. And we want Levi to know on this day, January the 20th, he was dedicated to the Lord. And regardless of what the enemy may do, I want you just to look around at this village and all of these beautiful people standing with you. There's no way in the world you can fail. And look in the front of you. We're your church family now. And I want you to know, she would do a drive-by and I'll do a drive-by. We want to see you in church. We want to see this beautiful baby in church. God bless you as you raise this child for the King. Yeah. God bless you, Mama. Continue to work. Thank you.
to God be the glory for the things he has done for me. There's another song that I like that says, if the Lord never does anything else for me, he's already done enough. And so he is worthy of our worship. At this time, we want to go before the Lord in prayer. If you have something on your heart that you particularly want to bring to God this afternoon, I would invite you to come down to the altar. You can kneel with us before the Lord or stand as we seek God together through our intercessory prayer. Let's go to the throne of grace together at this time. Our Father and our God, we come before you once again on this Sabbath morning, Lord, to acknowledge who you are and all that you have done in our lives. God, we come, some with broken hearts, some with cheerful hearts. Lord, we come from all different backgrounds and walks of life. Some have had great weeks, some have had terrible weeks, but regardless of what has happened during the week, we come today recognizing that you are the God who is able to make everything all right. We believe, Lord, that you are the God who works all things together for the good to those who love God, those who are the called according to your purposes. We recognize that you are the God who formed us before our parents even knew who we were. You are the God who has been watching over our lives from the very start. You are the God who was there behind the scenes even when we were wandering and going down our own path. We recognize that you are the God, the only God, who knows what is best for us. So, Lord, we come with hearts of worship, because first and foremost, we recognize that it is in you that we live and move and have our being, that we owe everything that we have to you. We recognize, God, that without you, we would be nothing. Without you, life would be meaningless. Without you, we would be sinners destined for condemnation. But Lord, we're so grateful. We come to worship you because we recognize that you're not only the God who created us, but that even after we sinned and we messed this thing up, Lord, you're also the God who did not turn your back on us. You're the God who created the plan of salvation. Lord, you're the God who went to Calvary for us. You're the God who offers salvation to each and every one of us. And so, Lord, we just stand and we say thank you. Words cannot express, God, the gratitude that we have in our hearts for all that you are and for all that you have done. And so, God, we just come to give all that we have to you. We come not just to give you words of confession, but we come to give you our very lives as a living sacrifice, Lord. We are giving you our lives. We're giving them back to you, Lord. We're asking that you would take these lives, Lord, that you would baptize us afresh and anew, that you would make us over anew, Lord, that you would work out your life through us. Lord, we're tired of doing our own thing. We've seen the results of doing our own thing, and we recognize how badly we need you. So So please, God, work a change in our lives. Let 2024 be a different year, not the same old status quo, but we're looking for something new, something different, something better. We want your direction for our lives. God, you see my brothers and sisters who are standing and kneeling here before the altar. Lord, I don't know what things are on their hearts, but you do. So right now, each and every concern, God, we want to present before you. You know the needs, Lord. You know whose heart is broken. You know whose relationship is messed up. You know who needs a financial blessing. You know, Lord, who needs a medical blessing, who needs healing. Lord, you know whatever the need may be, those who need direction, those who are confused, those who need to start over anew with you, God. Whatever the issue may be, we present them to you, and we ask, God, that you would address each concern in accordance with your will. Even as your children are walking back to their seats, we ask that they would feel peace right now because they know that the situation is in your hands. God, we pray that you would just be with our worship here today, that it might be pleasing in your sight. We pray that you would be with our speaker for the afternoon, that, Lord, you would use her to give us the words of life that we need to hear today. God, we pray just for this world that we are in, Lord. There's wars going on. There's natural disasters taking place. There are people who are hurting all around this world. And the world almost seems to be crying out, crying because it needs you. Lord, we believe that your return is soon. So we ask that you would help us to be ready. But then we ask that you would help us to help others to get ready so that we can all meet you in peace. That when you return, we can look up, we can say, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him and he has saved us. Prepare us for that day, God. For we ask these things in the name of Jesus and for his sake. Amen and amen.
He has a miracle.
guest speaker. And I want to introduce her to you this afternoon. Dr. Courtney Ray is an ordained Seventh-day Adventist minister, a clinical neuropsychologist, a neuroscience researcher, and an adjunct professor at City University of New York. She keeps busy. She is also the author of the upcoming book, Just Pray More and Other Church Myths About Mental Health. Ooh, I like the sound of that one. Pastor Ray earned her PhD in neuroscience and neuropsychology from Loma Linda University and her Master's of Divinity from the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary at Andrews University. Although she's a Bronx native, she's lived and pastored churches in St. Joseph, Michigan, Berrien Springs, Michigan, Baltimore, Maryland, Hanford, California, Compton, California, and Inglewood, California. She is founder and owner of Array Psychological Assessments, which provides neuropsychological evaluations across the lifespan. She is one of the founders of the Society for Black Neuropsychology. But more important than where she's been is where she's going, amen? She intends to make heaven her home and hopes you desire, by God's grace, to do the same. After our praise and worship, we will hear from Dr. Courtney Ray.
Happy Sabbath. How y'all feel? You guys are feeling okay? I see very few smiles, which to me would be an indication of feeling okay. Let me see some smiles. It's a great day, yes? It's today a good day? In fact, I would even say that today is the best day of my life. It's the day I have right now. I wake up every morning and I make a decision about what kind of day I want to have, how I want to show up in it. And every day I decide today is the best day of my life. Worship with us today. Worship in the knowing and the celebration that today is a good day. It doesn't matter what's behind you and what's ahead of you. It's none of your business. Today, right now in this moment, is the best day. Come on, y'all clap with us. Ready? Come on. Go ahead. Go ahead and get into it. It's okay. We're just gonna praise him for a little bit. We're gonna have a little bit of a party. Y'all ready? All right, here we go. Today will be the best day of my life. With us today. Yeah. Here we go. Well, today will be the best day of my life. Oh, yeah.
The best day.
Well, today will be best day. All right, here we go. Feel? You feel the blood pumping? Can you feel the energy flowing through your body? Can you feel that? That's the Lord. Y'all know that? That is the Spirit blowing through your body. Today is a good day. Listen, man, we've been through so much. Some of us are walking through stuff right now. Anybody walking through something right now? And this is kind of cliche sometimes, I know it, and then we say it as Christians and as people who believe in a God who is all everything. Sometimes we say he is more than able. But I wonder how much do we truly, truly believe that? When you're worried and you're sick and you're anxious and you're feeling all these things because you're trying to control your now instead of surrendering and understanding that he is more than able, more than I could even think or imagine. He is more than able. Do you believe that today? Okay, now take that belief and put it in your situation. Take it and wrap your situation in the belief that he is more. I like the song. It starts like this. It says, when did I start to forget all of the great things you did? And when did I throw away faith for the impossible? And how did I start to believe that you weren't sufficient for me? And why do I talk myself out of seeing miracles? You are more than able. If you believe that, just put your hands in the air right now and tell them. Say, you are more than able. Say it with me. Say, you are more than able. I believe it right now. Say, you are. You are more than able. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Do you believe that? Can you feel that? Let it just flow through your spirit. Come on, listen. Oh, I've got my confidence.
I've got my confidence back.
I put trust in the one who still.
Trust in the one who still does miracles. You do miracles.
You are more.
You are more than able.
Yes, la da da da. Oh yeah. You are more.
You are more than able.
You are, Lord. You are.
What the Lord can do, what the Lord can do,
and it's gonna happen.
It's gonna happen.
Yes.
Just in the way.
Yes. He's gonna move. You believe that? He's gonna move.
He's gonna move.
And can you imagine?
Can you imagine?
With all of the faith.
All of the faith.
What the Lord can do. Can you imagine what the Lord can do?
What the Lord can do.
And it's gonna happen.
And it's gonna happen.
Just let the way.
Just let the way.
You believe he still can do it?
Yeah.
Do you believe that right now in your situation? He still can do it right now. He still can do it. Listen, sing with me.
So you are more than able.
Oh, yeah. You are.
You are more than able.
You are more.
You are more than able.
Listen.
You are more than able.
Who am I?
Who am I to deny what the Lord can do?
I've come a long way.
Yeah.
I've seen how you work. There's so much goodness and grace, much more than I deserve. 'Cause I know who I am, and I can't stay where I'm at. Oh, we've come this far by faith, and I just can't turn back, 'cause he's not done with me yet. Oh, he's not done with me yet. Hey, there's so much more to my story, yeah, and I just can't turn back. He's not done with me yet. Oh, oh, he's not done with me yet. There's so much more.
There's so much more to my soul.
And he's not done with me.
Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? One time. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? He still can do it. He still can do it. Oh, who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do?
When you run out of literary devices to call out the depression, as I stand here trying to put pen to paper to produce poem, trying to give voice to the most dormant feelings I have, I see a suicide note. I see a death piece. I see imagery like my thoughts of using that closet to turn my wrist into waterfall, make a Red Sea of biblical proportions. When you run out of literary devices to call out the depression, as I stand here trying to put pen to paper to produce poem, trying to give voice to the most dormant feelings I have, I see
I'm not sure why it's not working, but it's okay.
I see a death piece.
This spoken word was one that I wanted to share with you because it was a man sharing his battle with depression. And we often don't hear that in our Black community. We often don't hear about that within, for our Black men talking about that. And we often don't hear about that in our church community either. Because a lot of times we are told that it's important to keep silent, even in the midst of our pain, but there is a likely chance that the person next to you, on your right or your left, is battling with some type of mental illness. Whether that's depression, anxiety, trauma from abuse, so many things we suffer with in silence. And today we are going to talk about breaking the sound of silence. I'm going to invite you all to pray with me this morning. Our Lord and our God, I thank you that you give us the spoken word through your Holy Spirit. Each and every day, we're able to hear you and hear what you desire us to do. I pray that we will listen to your voice and speak at your longing and your urging. I pray that as I speak today, that it will be your words, not mine. And may someone here hear the message that is for their heart and for their life today. In your name we pray, amen. So our ushers have a handout so that you can follow along with me. There is also a PowerPoint that I wanted to share. There's someone, the first slide is of someone that you would know who's very famous, and someone who is most well known for her words more than anything else. Because when we talk about silence, most of the time we think of people who are introverted, people who don't necessarily have much to say. But the individual that I want to start off talking about today is someone who is known for being a speaker, an outspoken activist, an outspoken poet, and none other than Dr. Maya Angelou. And if you don't know her entire story, you may not know that this prolific writer, this prolific speaker, this prolific poet, at a point in her life, she was captive by silence. And if you know anything about the autobiography that she wrote that she's most famous for, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, she talks about the journey that she went from being silent to finally finding her voice. You see, when she was about 8 years old, she had been sexually assaulted by one of her mother's boyfriends. And when she said something to someone, and she finally admitted to her family what happened, what actually wound up happening as a result was that this man was murdered after she said something. So he had gotten on trial. He was sentenced to just one day. And after his release, it's believed that her uncles decided that they would take justice into their own hands. And after this encounter, Maya said to herself, "I thought my voice killed him. I killed that man because I told his name. And then I thought I would never speak again because my voice could kill anyone." So at the age of 8 years old, she made a decision that she would silence her voice. And for 4 years, she never spoke again because of the shame that was something she felt based on something that was done to her. She was not the guilty one. She did not harm anyone, but the guilt and the shame that she adopted because of what was done to her caused her to suffer in silence and be held captive by that shame. And there are many people here today, you might not be selectively mute like she was, but there are many people here today who are being held captive by the shame and the mental anguish of trauma, of things that had nothing to do with your own actions. But we learn, especially in our communities, to keep inside business inside, right? Don't tell everybody outside what's going to happen. Don't tell everybody what's going on inside the house, right? And so you have people who wind up going day after day, holding on to these burdens that were placed on them by someone else through abuse, through trauma, through physical and mental sexual assault, all of these different things that they had nothing to do with. And this is not a phenomenon that is modern to us today. This is something that's been going way back in millennia. In 1 Samuel chapter 13, we hear of this same kind of thing where there is abuse, where there is pain, where there is trauma, and where shame brings silence. I'm going to read in your hearing 2 Samuel chapter 13. It's the story of Absalom, Amnon, and Tamar. It says, now it was after this that Absalom, the son of David, had a beautiful sister whose name was Tamar, and Amnon, the son of David, was in love with her. But Amnon was so frustrated on account of his sister Tamar that he made himself ill, for she was a virgin. And it seemed too difficult for Amnon to do anything to her. But Amnon had a friend whose name was Jonadab, and he said to him, why are you, the king's son, so depressed, morning after morning? Will you not tell me? So Amnon said to him, I am in love with Tamar, the sister of my brother Absalom. Jonadab then said to him, lie down on your bed, pretend to be ill, and when your father comes to see you, say to him, please have my sister Tamar come and give me food to eat, and have her prepare the food in my sight so that I may see it and eat from her hand. And Amnon lay down and pretended to be ill, and the king came to see him. And Amnon said, please have my sister Tamar come, make me a couple of pastries in my sight so that I may eat from her hand. Then David sent a messenger to the house of Tamar, saying, go now to your brother Amnon's house, prepare food for him. So Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house, and he was lying in bed. She took dough, she kneaded it, she made pastries in his sight, and baked the pastries. And then she took the tray and served them to him, but he refused to eat. And Amnon said, have everyone leave. So he isolated her. And then he said, bring the food into the bedroom so that I may eat from your hand. So Tamar took the pastries which she had made and brought them to the bedroom of her brother Amnon. And when she brought them to him to eat, he took hold of her and said, come sleep with me, my sister. Family violence. But she said to him, no, my brother, do not violate me, for such a thing is not done in Israel. Do not do this disgraceful sin. And as for me, where could I get rid of my shame? And as for you, you will be like one of the fools of Israel. Please speak to the king, for he will not withhold me from you. However, he would not listen to her, since he was stronger than she was, and he violated her and slept with her. Now, verse 15 is interesting. It says, after that, Amnon hated her with a very great hatred. Indeed, the hatred with which he hated her was greater than the love with which he loved her. And he said, get up, go away. And she said to him, now because this wrong in sending me away is greater than the other that you have done to me, yet he would not listen to her. He called his servants who attended to him and said, now throw this woman out of my presence, lock the door behind her. And it says that she had on a long sleeve garment, for this was how the virgin daughters of the king dressed in their robes. And his attendant took her out and locked the door behind her. And she took ashes and put them on her head. And she tore the long sleeve garment that she had. And she put her hand on her head and went on her way, crying as she went. And Absalom, her brother, said to her, has Amnon, your brother, been with you? But now keep silent, my sister, for he is your brother. Do not take these things to heart. Just shh. So Tamar has this violation done to her, And then she is told that she needs to quiet and silence her own voice. And you would think that the reason why is because this silence, of course, will make everything better. But of course it doesn't. Silence never makes things better. Not admitting, not giving voice to what has been done doesn't bring any resolution. There are many of us who think that if I just don't say anything, it will go away. But that's not how it works. It continues to corrode and destroy. Destroy inside of us and destroy even entire families. And in this case, it destroyed an entire kingdom. Because what happened from that point on was that David heard about it. He got angry. But that's it. It says Absalom decided he wasn't going to speak to Amnon, either good or bad, because Absalom hated Amnon because of what he had done to Tamar. And it said that 2 full years passed from that point. And so then Absalom decided that he was going to take matters into his own hands and rectify the situation. So he takes vengeance out on Amnon. And then because of that, now David's upset at Absalom. Then Absalom runs away, and then he tries to stage a coup. And then there's this entire internal family feud now between Absalom and David, based on something that Amnon did to Tamar 2 years before, because we kept quiet and didn't deal with the issues head on. There are so many times when we have people who know that there is something that could be done, but the shame of what is done, especially in our families, in the communities of trust, in our churches, among people that should be the people who are protecting us. And so we say, we're not going to say anything, and it doesn't help matters. It doesn't bring restitution. And it destroys entire churches. It destroys lives day in and day out when we say we don't want to talk about it. 10 years ago today, a young lady named Talika Patrick, and you may have heard of her. Talika and I did not know each other, but Pastor Le, as we were talking before, the Adventist world is very small. She grew up in New York, Dr. Pilgrim, so she was one of us. She was a New Yorker. And she also went to Loma Linda. So I would have crossed paths with her, I'm sure, and we had a lot of friends. And 10 years ago today, she was a resident in the Midwest, completing her doctoral residency. She was a physician. And she was working as a psych doctor, so psychiatrist in psychiatry residency at the hospital there. And you would think that because someone is in the medical field or someone is specifically in the mental health field, that we got it all together. We don't have any issues, right? And that's kind of the expectation a lot of times, is that you aren't going to say anything because you should know better. We say, you're Christian, so you don't have any problems, so you don't have to talk about being depressed or having any mental illness or anything like that. And so we keep these things quiet because that is the expectation that nothing is wrong. But in 2014, she was behaving quite erratically. People around her said that she seemed to be going through some mental issues, and there were things that were happening in her life, the way she was talking and interacting with people, that were making others concerned. But where was she going to get help from when she's in a profession that believes you should have it all together? When she belongs to a church, our church, the Adventist church, the Christian faith that says all you got to do is pray. Where was she going to get help in a community where we say we don't talk about those things, where we say keep that to yourself. And so it so happens that she wound up driving her car into a river. And we don't know all the things that happened and what led up to that exactly, but looking at videos and diaries and things like that, they suspect that she was going through a mental breakdown and didn't have anyone to turn to. Being silent, not having the ability, the freedom to say, hey, I'm going through something. Listen, this is what has happened to me. Letting someone know and know that you will not face judgment for sharing those things. That's what the church community is supposed to be. But instead, we come and we smile and we say, happy Sabbath. How are you? I'm fine. And we don't talk about what's really going on. Somebody in here is having an anxiety attack even as they're sitting down smiling. Someone in here is battling addiction. It might be a food addiction, a drug addiction. It might be a social media addiction. It might be a porn addiction. It might be any kind of addiction. But because they're here, they ain't gonna let you know about it. Someone here has been abused by someone that they trust. It might be a parent, might be a sibling, it might be somebody who they believed was a leader and someone that they looked up to, a mentor, but they've been told, be quiet. Don't say anything. But I'm here to tell you today that breaking the silence brings healing. Breaking the silence can give you that joy and restitution that you need that can never come from denying what has happened. The very first thing that we need to do before we get help is to admit we need help and to give voice to what is broken inside of us. Because you can't put back together something that is broken unless you admit that it's broken. In Mark chapter 10, there is I love this story. It talks about the blind man on the road who saw Jesus passing by. And he's there amongst the crowd. Everyone wants to see Jesus. Everyone is excited. And it says that this man, he decided that he would cry out and find out if that was the Son of God, if he could do something for him. And in verse 46 of Mark 10, it says, they came to Jericho, and as Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted what? All the more. He said, nah, you're not going to silence me because I know that I need something. And I'm not going to stay silent about it. I'm going to admit that there's something that's broken. And I'm not going to be ashamed. I'm not going to let you tell me to be quiet. And it says that he was there with his little cloak, sitting around waiting to see if somebody give him some money, but then he found out that there was somebody who got something that was more valuable than money who was passing by. And him sitting there, I can just imagine it, on the side of the road, not knowing who's going by, but he hears a murmur in the crowd. And he hears that this man that he has known to be a healer, that he has heard to be someone who can give him something that no one else has ever been able to give him, is passing by. And he says, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And they say, shh, man, you You're embarrassing us. The master's come to Jericho. You're going to make Jericho look bad. You're going to make us look foolish. Just sit there in your little corner. Don't say nothing. And he said, bump that. Jesus! Son of David! Have mercy on me! And it says that Jesus, I love this, he tells the guys who were telling him to be quiet, said, you guys, y'all call him here. So he used the people who were telling him to be quiet. Now you need to go and tell him to come here. And so he says, call him here. And they call the blind man saying, take courage, stand up, for he is calling to you. And it says that blind Bartimaeus said, you know what? Thank God. He threw off his cloak. He was like, thank you, Jesus, because you have something that I cannot get anywhere else. And I'm not going to let you or anybody else tell me that I can't get it because I have to be quiet about it. Because I know that when I break the silence, that's when I can get the healing that I need. Because if I sit here quiet, I'm never going to get the thing that needs to be fixed in me fixed. If I ignore the fact that there is something broken, how will I get that healing? You have to break the silence. You have to say, I am willing, no matter who tells me to shut up, no matter who it might embarrass, no matter who's saying that it's not the couth thing to do, that I'm going to get up and I'm going to say, I need healing. And when we have people who are willing to share their voice, then we're able to know that we are not alone in our suffering. I'm going to share with you a personal example. Yesterday I got in really late. My flight came in. It was delayed about an hour and a half. And so I didn't get back until like midnight, get here until about midnight. And the reason why I had taken the late flight in the first place is because yesterday was my mother's birthday, and I wanted to spend the day with her. Now, my mother has dementia, and for the longest time, it was very difficult for me to say that. And not because I was ashamed of her or ashamed of anything, but I felt that this is something she might not want people to know. You know, when people would ask, like, how's your mom doing? Oh, she's fine, you know. Because I didn't know whether or not if she would want people to find out. Inside business, right? That's family business. You don't need to tell everybody what's going on. And it was very difficult to go through that and having my mother go through these stages and knowing that I couldn't talk about it. Nothing that I did, nothing that she did. But there is a stigma and a shame for us that says we don't talk about certain things. We don't admit our weaknesses. And it wasn't until Sister Brenda Russell is here. I've been staying with her this weekend. She was able to share with me some of the things that she had been going through with her family. And that was a blessing to me to know that I was not alone. And then I found out that there were other people that I know whose family, whose parents were going through the same thing. And it felt like I didn't have to go through it by myself. And there are people here who need to hear your testimony too, who need to know that what they're going through is not something unique, that they are not going through whatever it is that they're going through by themselves. And sometimes we're so afraid, we're so caught up in what will people think of me, what will people think of this situation, that we don't stop to think, well, how would this benefit someone else? How might this be a blessing to someone else? So here I am, I'm here with patients, who some of them who have dementia. Some of them are parents of adult children who are coming and saying different things, and it was a blessing for them, for me, when I finally said to them, you know, I know what you're going through. And I could relate to them in a way that they didn't know that they could be related to at that point. Because now here I am, the person who is diagnosing them is able to say, I know what you're going through. I'm not just giving you a diagnosis. I'm telling you this is something that I can share with you from personal experience. And that made such a difference to people to hear that. Then when I had other friends whose parents started going through the same kinds of changes, they were able to talk to me and I was able to say, you know what, this happened and this is my experience. And we don't ever know how that testimony of what happened to us, whether we are a survivor of abuse, whether we are a survivor of mental illness, whether we are caregiving for someone with mental illness, whether we are going through something that is traumatic right now, because some of these things are not in the past for some of us. Some of us are going through it right now. You think that your marriage is going south? Guess what? There's somebody else who could tell you, hey, I've been there. We've had those ups and downs. We've had those struggles. And could you imagine what our church would be like if the people who were struggling now knew that there were other people on the other side who can give them hope? If people were vulnerable enough and open enough to say, my life hasn't always been easy. This relationship hasn't always been sunshine and roses. We haven't always had a great past. But I could tell you that it gets better. What would our church be like if we understood that your voice and your testimony could help free someone else? And we weren't ashamed. And where we were willing to share with others. John chapter 4, the woman at the well. Jesus comes into town, and she has no idea who he is. And it says that during that time, she just thought he was just another person, another guy. Maybe she thought he was trying to hit on her. And so she just was kind of evasive for a little while. And he asks her to give him something to drink. She's like, why are you asking me that? But then they get into deeper things. They talk about spiritual things. And then he tells her about her own life, her own trauma, her own history. He tells her, why don't you call your husband to come here? And she says, I don't have a husband. And he's like, nah, you don't. You have five husbands. And the one you're with now is not your husband. And she was like, so I hear that you're a prophet, huh? Because only a prophet would be able to tell her these things that she was too ashamed to speak out loud. And then she begins to know that this man is a man that not only knew her past, but who could bring her into a bright future. And so it says that she leaves her water pot. Notice how whenever people have an encounter with Jesus, they're just like, we're going to leave whatever we got and just go. And so she leaves her water pot right there, and she runs into the city, and she tells everyone, and she says, come see a man who has told me everything about my own life. This is a man that you need to know. Because I can tell you from my testimony how my past was this. And he is bringing me to a different future. See, she goes and she tells people about not only what Jesus did, but what she did as well. About her own past, about the trials and tribulations that she's been through. And it says, because of that, it says those people began to believe in him because of the word of the woman who testified, he told me all the things that I have done. So it says that because of her word, because of her testimony, because of her voice, she was able to reach someone that she would never have been able to reach if she had just stayed silent. And then we're told that many more believed because of his word, and they were saying to the woman, now it's no longer because of what you have said that we believe. For now we have heard enough, we know for ourselves that he is the savior of the world. Can you imagine how wonderful our testimony would be to the people of the world if we were able to go out and tell them, I have a Jesus who is concerned about your eternal salvation, and he's also concerned about your here and now. He's concerned about what's happening to you right now. He wants you to have life and more life more abundantly right now. That this is a God who wants to heal you right now, who sees your trauma, who sees your past, who sees your addiction, who sees the abuse, and who loves you right now. How many people would be able to say, because of your testimony, now I believe? Because of what you've gone through and the one that you know who's brought you through it, I believe. But it means we can't be silent. It means we can't pretend that we got it all together. It means that we can't just smile and say everything's fine. It means that we need to be willing to admit and to be vulnerable and to be open about the struggles that we have and the things that we've been through and the things that have sometimes been done to us. Because your voice can help free someone else. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. And when we can weep and rejoice together and say, together we are a church, we are a family, that no matter what has happened, we're going to go through this together. That's what God expects from our church. Amen. One day, soon I hope, there will be no more weeping, no more sorrow, no more trauma, no more abuse. And all these former things will be passed away. And when that happens, I will be glad. And until that happens, God has given us a refuge in one another. God has given us people to reach out, to walk alongside one another, and to let each other know that you are not alone. This afternoon, it's very simple. I just want to know if there's anyone here who's willing to walk alongside your brothers, your sisters in this place, and let them know that they are not alone. I don't know if you know this song, I Need You to Survive. Because we can't get through this by ourselves. We can't get through this isolated. We can't get through this being silent. But we need each other to survive what's going to happen. And so as the musicians play, I'm just going to ask, is there anyone here who's willing to say, I'm willing to be real today. I'm willing to not have just a facade, but I'm willing to make church a place where everyone will know that they don't have to be alone and they don't have to suffer in silence. If that is your desire today, I'm going to invite you to come forward as we pray together and say, I need you to survive. If you have gone through things, if you've known someone who's gone through something, and if you said, you know what? I'm willing to give my voice and lend my voice to heal someone else. If you're willing to say, today, we as a church are going to stop just having a facade. Today, we're going to raise up our voices. And we are going to stand beside those who are hurt, who are broken. And I'm willing to say that I am hurt and I am broken. That I'm going to invite you to come.
You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive.
Look to someone, say, I need you, you need me.
I need you, you need me. We're all a part of God's body.
Stand with me. Agree with me.
Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body.
Everyone here.
That every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive.
Let's pray. God, you see your children here being willing to come and stand before this altar, saying that we understand and we know that we have brokenness inside of us. There are situations that need healing in our families, in our communities, in our church, Lord. And God, we are not going to pretend like everything's fine. We're not going to stay silent and smile. We're not going to just be quiet and be small in the corner. We're going to say, God, have mercy on us. Have mercy on the things that we're dealing with, that we're struggling with our addiction, with our anxiety, with our depression, with our trauma. God, have mercy on us. And may we have mercy on each other. May we look to each other with compassion and with empathy and with love. I pray that we will lift each other up, support one another, let each other know that no one here is alone and no one has to suffer in silence. God, I pray today that everyone under the sound of my voice will have the support that they need from someone. That they will know that you are with them and that you have people in your church who you have sent to walk on this journey alongside them. I pray that we will all do what you have asked us to do, play our part to bless someone else. And when all is said and done, God, we pray that each person here will be ready to meet you again, because this world full of brokenness, pain and hurt and suffering, we don't want to stay here that long, Jesus. We long for when you come again. We long for when you come to bring us back to that place where we don't have to deal with any of this anymore. May we be ready. And may we be holding on to the hands of the people beside us and saying, lo, this is our God. We have waited for you. Thank you, God, for giving us the accessibility to healing. And thank you for giving us people to help us work through that healing as well. Let all those who believe in the loving name of Jesus, who believe that he is able, and who believe that he is a healer, say amen, amen, and amen.
Amen. Can we affirm at this time, Dr. Ray? God bless you for your ministry. God bless you for your boldness. This is a dilemma within our culture. This is taboo for someone to speak clearly and to be so profound in calling this abuse out. And I pray that today we will be caretakers of our brothers and sisters, that we will make this place a comfort zone for those who are hurting to find help. Can we pledge today to be that church that will welcome those who are hurting without judging them and without shutting them down? Do I have anyone that want to join me? Today we make that declaration that we are a church that will care for those who are hurting. We're here for you. God bless you as He moves us to a greater accountability for caring for one another. Thank you, Dr. Ray.
Would you please stand with me for our benediction? Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that we may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated and remain seated until the pastors and elders have exited, and then the ushers will usher you out. Thank you. Thank you.
good, say,
Lord, you are good and your mercy is great.